Grace and peace to you and God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning and welcome to this service of worship here at Duke University Chapel. Whether you are joining us electronically or on the radio or here in person this morning, it is our hope that today in worship you would encounter the living Christ. There are many opportunities to learn and fellowship and serve together presented in your bulletin. One of those opportunities is through the congregation's in-kind giving in the back pew collection. This month we are taking donations for Urban Ministries of Durham, and so we invite you to participate in that. Maybe you brought something today, but if not today, then the next week. If you don't decide to get involved with this kind of giving, we do hope that you will join us in service to our community in one of the many ways we get involved throughout the week and throughout the month. This evening at 5:15 p.m., Dr. Timothy Olson will be presenting Dancing Through the Centuries, an organ recital on the Flintrop. We believe that this will be a delightful concert, and we hope that you'll join us. If you come at 4 p.m., we'll be having our evensong service in Goodson Chapel, and then following that, you can come over here and enjoy the organ recital. Our Goodson Endowment guest preacher for this morning is the Reverend Dr. Jerusha Neal. Dr. Neal has been a gift to the Divinity School and the Duke community since coming a couple of years ago, and we are so delighted to have her. While she has never preached on a Sunday morning here, she has preached in this pulpit before for the Divinity community, so we are looking forward to the word of the Lord that you will bring to us and offer us today, Dr. Neal. Psalm 98 says, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises." Let us rise now as we are able to join the heavens and the earth in joyful praise of our Lord.
Thank you. Let us pray, centering our hearts, our lives, our words on our need of God's grace to show up here and now. Let us pray. Holy One, we gather in worship and we commit to bringing our whole lives into your care. Yet we confess that we would rather offer up our brilliance and tuck away our mess. So often we share our noble resumes and refuse to admit our faults and failings, our inadvertent lies, and our careless cruelties. For all the times that we hurt you by hurting others, for all the times we hurt you by hurting ourselves, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. For forgetting the gifts of your presence, for delighting in our pretense of control, for idolizing power and exalting in profits, for speaking thoughtlessly and being silent fearfully, for all the ways we use the labor of others and the resources of the earth as our own personal checking account without humility or hesitation, Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. When we act like we have everything together, reveal to us how much we need you. When we feel like everything is falling apart, reveal to us how much we can depend on you. In this moment and every moment, as we struggle to find the courage to claim the deepest confessions of our hearts, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Friends, once we were no people, now we are God's people. By the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit, our sins are forgiven. Hear these words and be at peace. And as a witness to the peace that starts in community between friend and stranger, let us prepare ourselves here now to pass the peace of Christ to those near and far. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. And also with you.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination, printed in your bulletin. God, our refuge and strength, as your word shapes our lives, bring near the day when war shall cease, poverty and pain shall end, and the earth may know the peace of heaven, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Job, the 19th chapter. Oh, that my words were written down. Oh, that they were inscribed in a book. Oh, that with an iron pen and with lead, they were engraved on a rock forever. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has thus been destroyed, then in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see on my side, and my eyes shall behold, and not another. My heart faints within me. This is the word of the Lord.
Hear me out, see how The New Testament lesson is from 2 Thessalonians, the second chapter. As to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered together to him, we beg you, brothers and sisters, not to be quickly shaken in mind or alarmed, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as though from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord is already here. Let no one deceive you in any way, for that day will not come unless the rebellion comes first and the lawless one is revealed, the one destined for destruction. He opposes and exalts himself above every so-called God or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, declaring himself to be God. Do you not remember that I told you these things when I was still with you? But we must always give thanks to God for you, brothers and sisters beloved by the Lord, because God chose you as the first fruits for salvation through sanctification by the Spirit and through belief in the truth. For this purpose, he called you through our proclamation of the good news so that you may obtain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So then, brothers and sisters, stand firm and hold fast to the traditions that you were taught by us, either by word of mouth or by our letter. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and through grace gave us eternal comfort and good hope, comfort your hearts and strengthen them in every good work and word. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise as you are able for the reading of the gospel. The gospel lesson is from Luke, the 20th chapter. Some Sadducees, those who say there is no resurrection, came to him and asked a question. Teacher, Moses wrote for us that if a man's brother dies, leaving a wife but no children, the man shall marry the widow and raise up the children for his brother. Now there were seven brothers. The first married and died childless. The second and the third married her. And so in the same way, all seven died childless. Finally, the woman also died. In the resurrection, therefore, whose wife will the woman be? For the seven had married her. Jesus said to them, those who belong to this age marry and are given in marriage, but those who are considered worthy of a place in that age and in the resurrection from the dead neither marry nor are given in marriage. Indeed, they cannot die anymore, because they are like angels and are children of God, being children of the resurrection. And the fact that the dead are raised, Moses himself showed in the story about the bush, where he speaks of the Lord as the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Now he is God not of the dead, but of the living, for to him all of them are alive. This is the word of the Lord.
Would you pray with me? Redeemer who lives, let your life now mark our own. Open our eyes and unstop our ears that we might leave this place different than we came in by the grace of your resurrection power. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. It's getting late in Luke's gospel. The shadows of Jesus's life are growing long. He's already fed the 5,000. He stood transfigured on the mountain. He's rode in on the donkey. And now he's in the temple right before Passover, teaching and telling the good news. We don't know why good news made the theologians who heard him nervous, but it did. In Luke 20, they come at him with their best shots, their best attempts to undermine and implicate him. They ask him all the hot button issues. They ask him about money. They ask him about politics. They ask him about spiritual authority. They even ask him about marriage, specifically marriage in the afterlife. That was our passage today. A woman married 7 brothers, buried them all, bore no children. In the resurrection, whose wife will she be? Now, most of these questions, the ones about taxes and Caesar, and the one that asks Jesus by what authority he does what he does, Jesus deflects. He asks a question back, or he redirects the conversation, or he tells a parable. This man is shrewd. He sees what these rhetorical jabs are meant to do, and he dodges as if he's not even trying. Nobody can land a punch. But when this question of marriage comes, Jesus changes his tone. He doesn't trade a question for a question. He doesn't tell any stories. He doesn't ask them to give him a coin. He gets down to theological business and he puts all his cards on the table. He speaks plain. He quotes scripture as if something different is at stake, and something is. Because this isn't actually a question about marriage. It's a question about resurrection. And when shadows grow long, when the sun is low in a human life, questions of resurrection are deadly serious. The particular believers who question Jesus in this passage are called Sadducees. They're a group of religious thinkers that didn't believe in life after death. And so we know, as Jesus knew, that their story is disingenuous. There is no woman. There are no 7 brothers. And they don't really expect a solution to this problem. This is a theological puzzle box that's meant to make the whole concept of resurrection seem farcical and chaotic and maybe even unethical. Whose will she be? They want to know, rather smugly, because there's no answer that makes any sense. Unless you've asked the wrong question. Maybe who the woman belongs to is not the most important thing to know. Maybe that question is only relevant in a world where marriage is about lineage and legacy. It is a question of ownership. It's a question of property, which only matters if marriage is a dodge of death. I mean, in the Sadducees' own words, that's why the widow remarries again and again, to give the dead brother children, to extend his name beyond the grave. But what if death had no more power? There's more to life in the age to come than escaping death, Jesus tells them. Things work differently. You're thinking too small. In the resurrection, human relationships are reordered. The worth of a woman is reframed. Resurrection isn't an extension of the age you know. It's an age you've got yet to imagine. And we still have trouble imagining it. When we face lengthening shadows, we theologians of both the armchair and tenured varieties, we still ask the question, whose? As in, whose inheritance and whose property? Whose denomination? We still snatch at questions of ownership when the chill of death is in the air. What is my legacy? What will I pass on and to whom? We can't even imagine different questions, much less different answers. And that might be enough for Jesus to say on that day in that temple so long ago. That might even be enough for Jesus to say today, calling the bluff of leaders whose visions of life are too small, casting a vision of a not yet world, a far off world. But it's not enough for me, because I'm still thinking about that woman. Not the woman who doesn't exist, the woman of the Sadducees' story. I'm thinking about a real woman who's living right now, today, being treated like property, like a means to an end. And I'm wondering what this passage says to her, what the good news is for her. She may not have had a choice in who she married, or she may have made that choice before she knew what was at stake. She may be at the mercy of circumstances beyond her control, displaced by bullets or drought or a landlord that keeps raising the rent. She may have been taught from an early age to bite her tongue and lower her expectations. She may be carrying a weight of grief. I'm going to speak plain. I'm going to show you my cards. Because resurrection is a deadly serious subject. I want this passage to say more to her than wait. Wait for the resurrection day, that new age when death is no more. Wait for your life to be more than an issue to be debated, or your vocation as a child of God to be honored. Wait for that day when you're like an angel and you don't have to worry about this world anymore. I want Jesus to do more than cast a vision of the world to come. I want that vision to change this world. And at first reading, Jesus' description of those two ages seemed to have nothing to do with each other. There's no point of contact between them. Not even marriage crosses that chasm. So what difference does resurrection make? In marriages now, in denominations now, in the streets of Durham now. The shadows weren't long two Tuesdays ago, when Xavion Tucker crossed Driver Street. It was 2 p.m. He was 17 years old. He was shot in broad daylight, and he died in the front yard of Shepherd's House United Methodist Church. Right here in Durham. I'm not ready to talk about an age of resurrection that is so hard to see when the losses of death are so real. Jesus tells this certain sure group of scholars all will be different in the coming age, and that's fine and good, but we aren't in that age. We are here. We marry. We divorce. We bury our dead. We are not angels. Last weekend, before her college fellowship's All Saints worship service, my daughter found herself with a group of Durham teenagers, several of whom knew Xavion. They were visiting the Durham Memorial Homicide Quilt together, which is a project that was started by Sidney Brody in 1994. And since that year, Brody has added a patch to that quilt for every homicide victim in Durham. My daughter's lived in Durham about 2 years, and she was taken aback by the size of the quilt. But those she was with were focused on the particularity of the squares themselves. "I bet I can find my uncle's name," one said. Brody had already added Xavion to the quilt. In an interview over the summer, He spoke of 3 days last spring when he added a square every day. And normally, he closes the border of the quilt after every square that he adds. But after 3 days of having to rip open the border and add a square and then restitch it shut, he left it open. "I got tired," he said. Wendell Berry tells us to practice resurrection in his well-used poem. "Every day do something that won't compute. Work for nothing. Ask questions that have no answers. Plant sequoias." What Berry doesn't describe is how to sustain that work over decades. How does one keep from getting tired? Sometimes, people of God, you have to watch not just what a preacher says, but how they say it. The images they use, the pictures that they draw on, the stories they tell, and you better do that particularly when the preacher's Jesus. How Jesus teaches often has great significance for what he teaches. And I don't think it's any mistake that Jesus ends up right where he does in this gospel passage, standing next to Moses in a burning bush. I mean, it's an odd scriptural choice. If he was doing a lesson on marriage, Genesis 2 would have made more sense. But I think Jesus is doing more than putting icing on his argument. He's doing more than proof texting his point. I think he's giving us a picture of what it looks like when resurrection breaks into history, when resurrection touches the now. He doesn't explain it, because some things can't be explained. But he shows it through a story that every one of his listeners knows, through a flaming bush that's not consumed, through a divine voice that calls in the wilderness, through the dusty ground of the present made holy. Jesus moves past preposition into proclamation. He blows right through prose into poetry, because as it turns out, he wants more too. He wants more for that woman, and he wants more for the streets of Durham. He wants more even for those Sadducees, even for us. I love how he pays attention to those present tense verbs. God is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, not God was. I love that this God of the living calls Moses to the biggest fight of his life, not for some future abstraction, but a present tense fight that's waited long enough. But mostly, I love that this God of resurrection refuses to concede God's people to an age of death and empire, pressing this age against the age that is coming in a conflagration of love. If you squint, you can almost see them. Isaac and Abraham and Sarah and Hagar and Rebecca and Rachel shining in the fire of God's urgency like All Saints' candles. Not erased, but changed, testifying to a love bigger than they knew, glowing off the contours of Moses' face until he himself seems lit with flame, alive in God, alive to God. Maybe Jesus needed to hear the story himself. Maybe he needed to see that flame again and remind himself before he heads into the week to come that resurrection makes a difference. Perhaps the shadows of your life are growing long. Or you see those lengthening shadows in the life of one you love. Come close to the flame. Feel the heat on your cheek. There is no investment of your heart that will be lost or wasted, but it will be changed. Held secure in the heart of God It will testify to a love bigger than you know. And it will light the world. Perhaps the shadows of your faith are growing long. Maybe you know a woman who is a faintly burning wick, or maybe you are that woman. Let God's call find you in your wilderness. Your life matters. Your light matters. So do not wait. Turn your face to the light of God's coming and shine. Or maybe the light of your hope, the shadows of your hope, are growing long. You're tired of the not yet. You're tired of the ripped border of promise. You're tired of death. I am too. Take the shoes from off your feet, for the ground on which you stand is holy. You do not belong to fear or pharaohs, and you are not your own. You belong body and soul, in life and in death, to your faithful Savior. Which means that today, this day, the God of resurrection is raising you. Go! Practice that resurrection. You're not alone in the work. Sidney Brody doesn't kid himself. He knows quilt squares aren't going to fix Durham's violence, at least not overnight. But he doesn't leave the border of his quilt open anymore. I close the border after each square, he says, in hope that the quilt is finished forever. I think the city is worth the fight. Amen.
Thank you. Would those who are joining the congregation please come forward while the rest of you be seated. It is our joy and our privilege this morning to welcome new members to the congregation at Duke University Chapel. And standing before you are five individuals who come to us not as strangers, but as brothers and sisters in the family of faith. And as is characteristic of our congregation, we draw people from all over the Triangle area, and not one of these saints of God is from Durham. They come to us from Raleigh and Cary and Hillsborough and come to join with us as the family of faith. So friends, you come to us as members of the one holy and Catholic Church into which you were baptized and by which you have been nurtured. We are one with each other, sisters and brothers in the family of God. We rejoice that you have chosen to publicly proclaim the congregation at Duke University Chapel as your spiritual home. As you join with us in worship, education, mission, and fellowship, it is fitting that together we reaffirm our faith, which binds us to one another and to God. I ask, as these new members affirm their faith, that all those who are members of the congregation, please stand and do so with them. And also, I invite all of you who are seated or standing to answer these questions, which are printed in your bulletin. Do you believe that God has reached out to us with love and forgiveness? Will you seek to grow in faith through participating in worship, study, service, and celebration?
We will.
Will you strive to embody Christ's compassion and holiness?
We will.
Let us pray. Holy God, we praise you for calling us to be a servant people and for gathering us into the body of Christ. We thank you for these sisters and brothers who are now members of the congregation at Duke Chapel. In all things, we pray that you will deepen our connections with one another and with you. Together, may we live in your spirit and so love one another that we may have the mind of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom we give honor and glory forever. Amen. Let us welcome these new members.
The Lord be with you.
Let us pray.
Lord God, you hold the future in your hands, and you have made for us an eternal legacy in your resurrection. We give to you our futures, those we hope for and those we dread. Disrupt our ways of being in the world that are counter to your kingdom economy of mercy. Where our desires for the future run counter to your kingdom, redirect us into your paths of justice and truth. We hold before you all those who long for justice today. Especially we remember all who have been victimized by the violence in our city. We acknowledge before you that our whole community suffers when even one suffers. So send your peace, send your restoration, send your new life to make something beautiful where scarcity and violence and death have left destruction and ruin. May the seeds of hope that are grounded in your resurrection come to bear new life in Durham and throughout your world. You live to silence all our fears. You live to wipe away our tears. You live to calm our troubled hearts. You live all blessings to impart. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, you give us the breath of life, and in you we live and move and have our being. Draw near to all who struggle to find life in the midst of challenging circumstances. Bless any whose employment has become unbearable. open opportunities for gainful employment to any seeking it today. Cherish each one who faces chronic unemployment or who struggles with other barriers to their flourishing. Strengthen all who work in our city to empower people with material need. Inspire our community by your Spirit to care for the needs of all and to love our neighbors as you have loved us. You live and grant us daily breath. You live and we shall conquer death. You live our mansion to prepare. You live to bring us safely there. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, you have created us to be in relationship with you and with one another. Shape each of our relationships to mirror yours. In a moment of silence, we name before you the places in our lives that are in most need of your healing touch. May you be all sufficient for our every need. When the relationships that we long for have failed to thrive or even to begin, give us grace. Give us life. Give us hope. Nurture in your arms of grace any who long for a connection with a partner, or a child, or a loved one who has died. Give us the eyes of your resurrection, that we may see you beyond the age of death, and that we may be bold to live the difference made by your resurrection. You live triumphant from the grave. You live eternally to save. You live exalted, throned above. You live to rule your church in love. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus, we know that you are our Redeemer and you live. What comfort this sweet sentence gives. You live, who once was dead. You live, our ever-living head. Amen. Kate Regani, the Director of Development and Communications for Farmer Food Share, is here to present to us this month's Mission of the Month announcement.
Hi, everyone. And as Bruce mentioned, my name is Kate Regani, and for the past 3 years, I've had the privilege of working at Farmer Food Share, an organization here in Durham that creates opportunities for more people across North Carolina to access fresh food. Would you believe that 1 in 5 North Carolina children are food insecure, and that nearly a third are obese? These are often the same kids, and it's due to the fact that the food that their families can afford isn't healthy. The food they need is growing right here in North Carolina too, but family farmers struggle to get it to them. And that's where Farmer Food Share comes in, by linking growers and eaters together in ways that work. We started through food donations at farmers markets, and you can still find us there and volunteer. But now many of the hunger relief organizations you know and perhaps support, organizations like Table and Porch and the IFC, now buy produce through North Carolina farmers via Farmer Food Share's wholesale market. Your support makes these connections possible, and it's not just small nonprofits. Duke University buys and serves North Carolina produce and dairy to serve on East Campus. You can find and buy it at the Durham Co-op and at Weaver Street Market. Some of you probably have kids at Durham Public Schools. All 33,000 of those students have the chance to eat North Carolina-grown veggies each week in their cafeterias through Farmer Food Share. A fun fact, if you look at the weekly menu to see what the schools are serving, if you look for the items in blue, those are sourced through Farmer Food Share. So even if your families only buy school lunch occasionally, those are the days to do it. Because we know exposure is key, we also offer taste tests in the cafeterias, which give the kids a chance to taste and learn about the veggies on offer. Would you believe that among the 8,000 kids we work with, more than 75% say they like or love both collards and kale when they taste it? Pretty cool. We believe in working with communities and the organizations that support them, helping them create systems that work for them, because we're all different, and the challenges that face one community are likely different from another. We're grateful to be part of a community that believes that change is needed and that it's possible for everyone to access fresh, healthy food. And it's all because of people like you. If you have questions or would like to get involved, I'll be back in the narthex. Feel free to stop by the table on your way out. But thank you for the opportunity to be here and to speak with you all today. And God bless you for all you do.
Thank you, Kate. All of the cash offerings and checks written to Duke University Chapel this morning will go to Farmer Food Share. May your giving be giving to the Lord for the gifts of the kingdom to be spread all across our city.
Thank you.
Take us as we are, O great Jehovah. Claim us as your own. Show us we are not alone. What we have is yours. Reframe our offerings, reclaim our lives by your resurrection power. Through these gifts and offerings, through this very worship, empower us to testify to the conflagration of your abiding and abundant love. All this we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus, who gives us the courage and the strength to pray together once again, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory of the
As we prepare to leave this place, go forth. And may the love of Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness and protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into these doors. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.
Come on.